أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق أجمعين، سيدنا محمد عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين. اللهم إن نسألك علما نافعا، وعملا صالحا متقبلا، ورزقا حلالا طيبا يا أكرم الأكرمين. وبعد. So last time we started the second section of the book about the fiqhi rulings of ibadah, of the act of worship. We started with the tahara, with the physical purification of the body to be ready to establish or to perform the ibadah, and specifically the salah and any other kind of ibadah or act of worship that requires tahara or physical tahara. Right, just to connect the dars today to what we had last time, what are the obligations of wudu? A quick oral pop quiz. So the obligations of wudu. So can we raise hands, please? Yes.
Intention.
Washing
the face.
Washing the face.
Washing the arms between the elbows. Mm-hmm. Washing your touching the like your scalp. Mm-hmm. Washing your feet.
And doing it in the right order. Jazakallah khair. Those are the obligations of wudu, the six obligations of wudu. Okay, what are the boundaries of the face that we have to wash in the wudu? Yes. Sorry, say that again.
Hairline, chin, then ear to ear?
And ear to ear, yes. Jazakallah khair. When we say the intention in wudu, so which kind of intention that you have to have before starting your wudu? Mm-hmm. How do you make that? How do you perform that intention? It's inside the heart, but how do you express about it? What's the thought that comes to your mind?
Purification.
Purification. Or any kind of purification or a certain kind of purification.
Purification for salah.
Purification for salah. Purification to give me the ability. I mean, the legal ability to perform the act of worship like the salah. When a person breaks his wudu, what are the things that he cannot perform and do until he make wudu again? Salah. What? Tawaf around the Kaaba. And touching the Quran, the actual copy of the Quran. And this is, and sujood al-tilawa. This is about the minor impurity, as we call it, or the minor ritual impurity. We said when we use the term impurity, we do not mean the person is physically impure, we mean he's ritually impure, which means he cannot perform this ibadah until he actually makes wudu again. There's a minor impurity and there is a major impurity, right? So with the major one that requires bath or a shower, what are the things that a person cannot perform and do when he's in the state of a major impurity? Yes? Yes? Exactly. All what we mentioned about the minor impurity plus entering the masjid or staying in the masjid and reciting the Quran or the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, if a person gets sick and he loses his consciousness for a couple hours, that breaks his wudu? He had wudu before that, and then because of his sickness, he lost his consciousness. So when he wakes up, or when he gets out of this state, does he have to make wudu again?
Yes.
Accordingly.
If what?
If he was sitting, he doesn't make wudu.
Which position of sitting? Yes.
It has to be like I'm sitting right now. It can be on the side.
Okay, so Yes, he has to be like firmly seated.
Yes.
This is in any kind of as they say literally in fiqh, losing the mind. Losing the mind means like sleep, sickness, whatever the reason, or gets intoxicated. If you are firmly seated on a seat or on the ground or anything similar, that means your wudu is okay. Even if you slept or you lost your mind for a long time, you still your wudu is okay. Well, if you're lying down even for a few minutes, that means your wudu is gone and you have to make wudu again. Okay, last time we talked about the obligations of wudu, we talked about the nullifiers or the invalidators of wudu. We didn't talk maybe in detail about the sunan of wudu. So these six obligations that we mentioned, those are the main obligations or integrals that you have to perform for wudu to be valid. But there are a lot of recommended actions that you are highly recommended by the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to perform in your wudu. And again, obligations, if you didn't do them, the ibadah is not correct. The ibadah is not valid. The wudu itself is not valid, which means the salah will not be valid too. The sunan, if you do not do them, your ibadah is valid, but you lose tawab. And some of these sunan, the Prophet ﷺ promised, which is a kind of a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with a great tawab if you actually perform all those sunan. So if we want to count from the beginning of the integrals or the foundations or the essentials of wudu, what is the first sunnah that a person does? Now you want to make wudu. What is the first sunnah? Basmala, saying Bismillah. Okay, and then? Yes, washing the hands. And we said last time that you have to wash them again when you are washing your hands and your arms after your face. And then? Rinsing the mouth with water. Yes, and rinsing the mouth and then rinsing the nose with water. What else? So can we get more people participate, please? I'm assuming everybody makes wudu. So you can actually say what you guys experience when you make wudu. So after you rinse your mouth and nose, what you do? Yes. Your face, that's a farad. Your face. And sunnah is to do it three times, right? That's a sunnah. How do you count the three times, by the way? So for example, if I wash my face with water, but I haven't yet fulfilled the obligation of washing all the face with the boundaries that we explained, does this count as one? Because sometimes, you know, sometimes you need to pour water like two, sometimes three times until you are sure that you actually washed all the boundaries of the face. So let's say I did it for three times. This counts as one or three? Did you get that question? No. Okay, so now I'm washing my face. Sometimes I took some water, I put them on my face. This part, for example, is not washed yet. I haven't done washing my face yet. So I took water again and then I put it on my face to make sure that the whole boundaries of the face that we just talked about, which actually are included in the washing thing. So now these two times count as one time or two times?
One time.
One time. Are we clear on this? Because yes, it counts only one time. And then you do the second and then you do the third. So when you say washing the thing three times, that means after the second one, it's after you fulfill the obligations, because the second and the third are actually sunnah. The first one is the essential or the fard one. Okay, what are other sunnah or recommended things in wudu? Yes?
The ears,
wiping the ears with water. And doing the full head, because we said last time, according to the school of thought, the full head is not an obligatory. You do part of it, that's enough. But doing the wiping your head from the front to the back and then going forward, that's actually a sunnah. And you do it three times too, by the way. And you do it three times too. When you put your hands like this and you go all the way to the back and then you go to the front. Okay, that's the full sunnah. The fard is you wipe over any part you want. No. Three. The sunnah, fard is one time, any part. Sunnah, three times all over the head. And by the way, going to the back and then coming, that's one. Sometimes it depends on the length of the hair, because like how do you wipe over your hair? Some people, if they don't have a lot of hair, maybe they would count as two.
Is the ears just one seat?
The ears are three too.
Three times?
Yes, three times. So, sorry, let's not have questions now. We just count the sunan of wudu and then we'll have all the questions at the end, because we're going to have a lot of questions. Any other sunan in the wudu? washing between the fingers and the toes. That's a very important sunnah. That's a sunnah if the water already reaches there. If the water didn't reach between the fingers and between the toes, that's not a sunnah, that's a must, you have to do. If you're not sure if the water goes between your fingers or between your toes, you have to make sure the water goes there. Okay, I'm sure the water reached that between the toes and the fingers. Now doing extra washing there, that's actually be a sunnah. Did you get that? So again, because we said last time, even in the ghusl, so in the showering, you have to make sure the water reaches all the parts that you have to wash in the ghusl or in the bath. What else? Sunan?
The beard for men.
What?
Putting water through the beard.
Putting water through the beard for men. That's also a sunnah. Yes, and rubbing the limbs of the body that you wash in the wudu, that's a sunnah, al-dalq. We said some other schools, they consider this to be a fard, by the way. But according to this madhab, you don't have to do that. If you remember, we said if you put just your hands, for example, under the water, that should be enough. But rubbing the part of your body, that's actually a sunnah. What else?
Al-Muwala.
Doing that in a kind of a sequence. Is that an obligatory thing or a sunnah? So I'm making wudu at home, I wash my face, and then I wash my arms, and then I got a phone call. So I stopped, and then I picked up the phone, I had a phone call for like 3 minutes. Then I went back. So can I just continue and do my head and then my feet, or I have to start over?
If your limbs are not dry,
oh, so it depends if my limbs are dry or not. Okay, any other answers for this? Okay, so according to this madhab, the surprise is no, it's not a fard. So if you go and you do whatever, for sure that's not recommended. But if that happens and you come back, you can just continue. Even if the limbs are dry, by the way. Even if the phone call was like for 5-6 minutes, or maybe more, you can do that. But that's not recommended. It's better to start over. But if you didn't, that's okay. The wudu will be okay. Because the muwala, they call it the muwala, the sequence of making these obligations of wudu. It's not an obligatory thing. It's a sunnah to do that. And there are hadith and stories from the sahaba that they actually would pause during making the wudu and they would continue without redoing it again. What are the other sunnah of wudu? So there is a sunnah, or it could be a makruh, because we count the makruh things too. The things that not recommended or disliked, or we call them the offensive things, that use so much water or too much water. Al-israfu fil ma', the excessive use of water, that's actually something that is not recommended. And the Prophet ﷺ, he commanded his companions not to use much water in lots of situations and hadith sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Also sunnah not to speak with people when you're making wudu. I mean, that's not going to invalidate your wudu, but it's better not to. You focus on your wudu, because there are a lot of ad'iyah in the wudu, by the way. There's a dua at the beginning, bismillah, then there is dua in the middle, and there is dua at the end. So it's a ibadah, you're performing a ibadah. Yes, it's a mean to perform another ibadah too, but it's a ibadah itself. So it's better to focus on your wudu and to make dhikr and to make the ad'iyah that are like reported from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Any other sunan for wudu? How about doing the right hand before the left hand? That's an obligatory thing or a recommended thing? Sunnah or fard? So if you by mistake wash your left hand before your right hand, your wudu is okay? Obviously that would happen with the feet and with the hands, right? So it's actually a sunnah, it's not a fard. But again, when we say it's a sunnah, that doesn't mean that you on purpose do something against the sunnah. You just follow the sunnah. But if it happens by mistake, if it happens like you were not really aware of this, that's okay. It's not something that you have to do in your wudu. If someone actually jumps into water, like in a pool or lake or whatever, does that count as wudu? And he had the intention. Does that count as wudu?
Yes.
And how about the odor? He has to jump.
Dive head.
So no, he didn't do that. So does that count as wudu? There was no order followed in this.
Isn't it that like if it's on the water, like if it's not running, it's not cleaning or whatever?
No, let's assume the water is clean. Not yeah, the scenario is that the water is really clean. But the question is about the taking or doing the wudu in the order that we mentioned to be one of the obligations of wudu. So this is one of the exceptions that would be considered as wudu. The only condition is the intention. If you have your intention, then you jump in the water, that considers as wudu. That would be considered as wudu. And that would be considered as ghusl too if you do the same thing. Right? Okay, if he jumps in the water and he wants to do the three times washing, how can he do that? He jumps. Can he just move like in circles in the water? Okay. So he can have the intention of like performing wudu, and that will be considered as wudu, and inshallah he will get most of the thawab for all of these sunan of wudu too. That's one point that maybe we didn't talk about in detail last time. Those are the majority of the sunan of the wudu. One other point that we didn't also maybe talk about is qada ul hajj, as we call it in fiqh, when we use the washroom, which most of the times or a lot of times would happen actually before doing the wudu. There are a lot of ahkam related to this, and it's very important, right? And something that we have to keep in mind that when we talk about these details, sometimes we feel like, why are you making it complicated, right? Just keep it simple, like whatever wudu, inshallah, will wash all the what we can wash. We use the washroom in any way, and inshallah, Allah will accept that. No, you need to take that serious. You really need to take that serious. The Prophet ﷺ, he was walking with his companions, he passed by a grave. And he said, those two people in this grave, they are being tortured right now. And they're not tortured for something really major that you would think they were like a very like evil doers. They said, one of them, he used to like commit backbiting and befall between people. And the other one, he wouldn't purify himself after relieving himself in the washroom. That was a reason of the punishment in the grave for that person. He wouldn't purify himself after like literally urinating. And he's being tortured in the grave. So when you read this hadith, you understand the importance of tahara and understand that you have to take these things seriously because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to do this. So when you talk about the details of using the washroom, the details of wudu, the details of these tahara ahkam, they are very important. And it's very important to spend some good time on them in our life to make sure we are performing them right. And then when we are responsible for other people, when we have a family, for example, and we are responsible for raising kids, you have to make sure that we teach them the way they would make wudu and they would establish this ibadah too. Because it's a fard upon the parents to teach the kids these things. It's not an option that the parents would just offer their kids. It's a fard on them. It's a must. And some scholars and some of the sahaba, they said the tafsir of the ayah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا, is this. Or you had believed, protect yourselves and your families from the hellfire. They said, part of the interpretation of this ayah is that you teach them what would protect them from the hellfire. That's why it's a must, because it's a command, it's an amr from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, you have to protect yourselves and to protect your families. Part of that process of protection is to teach them, and Imam al-Shafi rahimahullah explained this ayah, he said, to teach them how to make wudu, to teach them how to pray, to teach them that stealing is haram, that zina is haram, these major sins are prohibited in Islam. These basically the foundations of Islam, is the meaning of this ayah. And it's a must upon the parents. So we take these things seriously. That's the lesson. So when we use the washroom, there are a lot of things that we have to learn that are obligatory that we have to take care of. And there are a lot of other sunan recommitted things that we have to, or we are highly recommitted to follow as well. Among them, the dua that you say when you are entering the washroom and leaving the washroom. When you enter in the washroom, you enter with your left feet first, right? And you say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith. You seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala against the demons, males and females. That's the famous meaning of this hadith. When you are leaving, you leave with your right feet first, and then you say ghufranak in one hadith. You ask Allah for forgiveness. Or you say, Allah, alhamdulillah, alladhi adhaba anni al-adha wa afani. And look at the beauty about these hadith that you are expressing gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this little ni'mah that sounds little to you, but it's a big ni'mah. Because if you couldn't relieve yourself, you can't imagine what is going to happen to you. So you say alhamdulillah, you praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for making you able to actually relieve yourself like this. And when you enter the washroom, you make sure you do not take with you anything that has the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or any glorified name, like a mushaf, for example, or like a paper that has something like this. That's in general. There are some exceptions. The Prophet ﷺ had a ring. This ring was written on it, the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he would take it off before he enters the washroom, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's a sunnah that you do not like spend long time in the washroom. So do not take your phone with you in the washroom, right? Because that's a generation problem. So because it's not really recommended that you spend long time in the washroom. By the way, when we say in washroom and fiqh, we mean using the washroom, like using literally the toilet. Because some people get confused about this, right? Sometimes there are, in modern sense of washrooms, now they're much bigger than before and there are other things that you can do there, right? So we use in, when you say qada'ul haja, when you are literally relieving yourself. This, most of these ahkam actually apply to this. It's sunnah that you do not speak or talk to people when you're doing this too. That's a sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ wouldn't respond to people when they call on him when he's relieving himself. It's a sunnah that you do not face the qibla when you're doing this. But what if the house is built like this or the washroom has been designed like this? It's okay. This sunnah is actually applicable for the people who would relieve themselves, for example, in like in an open space. Back in the days, people in the desert, they would have like certain areas that they would do that there. So if you are, if you have the option basically not to face the qibla, it's actually haram to face it if you know that you're facing it. Again, in open space. But you are in a building, and the building or the washroom is being built or designed like this, that's okay. There is no prohibition or there's no even karaha in this. These are sunnah. But the most important thing is we have to understand how to use the water to purify ourselves or how to use something else. So most of the times you use like tissues or napkins, right? Or tissues in the washrooms. So tissues can work as an alternative for the water, yes. But we have to make sure that, number one, use them 3 times at least, right? So you use 3 like tissues or whatever, how do you shape them? 3 times at least. 3 times is a condition, and one more condition, you have to make sure that you removed all impurity that you, that came out from you. You have to make sure as much as you can that you purified the whole thing. Okay, what if I want to use water? It's actually better to use water if it's available. Okay, can I use both? Yes, you can. You can use both, right? So this is general. There are a lot of details, but this is just the general ahkam. Water is preferred actually if you have water. If you do not have water, you can use the tissues, which is the common thing. And when you use the tissues, you have to use them 3 times, because 3 times is the minimum that you can make sure that you actually remove the filth or remove the najasa that's that comes from your body. And then today the we'll move to the new topic in the fiqhi section of the book, which is the salah. So now we got a good idea about the tahara, about purification, about wudu and ghusl, and what is related to them. And again, because that's a very short book, we're taking only the basics. In a little bit advanced books, the chapter of purification of tahara is actually much longer than this, and there are a lot of other details. There are a lot of other things that we didn't talk about, but we just want to cover the basics. Can we keep the questions at the end? Sorry. Is there a question? Okay, we'll take that quick. I can't hear you, sir.
If you delay yourself after being a wudu, can you change or do you have to go in the wudu again after you change?
If you do what after wudu?
You dirty your clothes or whatever, something falls on you and you get dirty.
Oh, we said that last time. So something falls on me, then it came out from me? No, I don't have to make wudu again. I need to make sure my clothes are clean. So I change my clothes, I don't have to make wudu again. I change my clothes or I purify them.
If you vomit, then you have to, right?
No. No, because thrown up is not actually an invalidator of wudu. Okay. We didn't count it as invalidator of wudu. But it's a najasa, so you have to clean it. Okay. So, and then the chapter of prayer. We call it Islam as-salah, right? And as-salah literally means a dua. That's the linguistic meaning of this word. Dua means supplication. Sallaytu ay da'awtu. When you supplicate, this is the meaning of salah. The technical definition of salah, it's a set of actions and utterances that begins with saying Allahu Akbar, ends with saying Assalamu Alaikum, and is performed according to specific conditions. This is in the first paragraph in page 20. This is the technical definition of a salah. If you remember the first lecture, we talked about definitions and how to make definitions. This is how to make a legal, logical definitions of things. This is a very accurate definition. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. Prayer at fixed times has been enjoined on the believers. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Islam is based on 5 pillars, بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ عَلَى خَمْسٍ. And one of those 5 pillars is as-salah. How many obligatory prayers? 5. Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, and Isha. These are the only 5 obligatory prayers. The evidence for this is a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam He's a Bedouin. He came from the desert, and he asked the Prophet ﷺ about the essentials of this religion. And the Prophet ﷺ told him there are five prayers that Allah has written them upon slaves in the day and night, which are the five that we just count. So the man said, am I required to do others? So the Prophet ﷺ said, no, unless you volunteer. So we understood from this that those aren't the only five obligatory prayers. Any other kind of prayer that's actually recommended that a person would do to get extra thawab from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the noon prayer, which is the dhuhr, and then the mid-afternoon prayer, which is asr, the sunset prayer, which is maghrib, the night prayer, al-isha, and the dawn prayer, which is al-fajr. Those are the five obligatory prayers. In the Hanafi madhab, for example, they have one extra prayer that is wajib and not fard. So in the Hanafi school of thought, that's just a side point, they have differentiated between something called fard, which is obligation, and something called wajib, which is a lower level of obligation or lower level of mandatory things. So it is a mandatory, but not as the obligation. They have this, it's a kind of terminology that is special about the Hanafi madhab. And they added one extra prayer to this, which is Salatul Witr. You know, which you are recommended to do them at the end of your night before you sleep. Or if you can wake up before Fajr and you pray it, at least one raka'ah or more, you better do it before Fajr if you're able to wake up. It's very highly recommended according to all the scholars. There are a lot of hadith that talk about very big reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for people who commit to Salat al-Witr. But the Hanafi madhab, for how much they consider Salat al-Witr to be important, they said it's wajib. Again, it's not as the five prayers, but he said it's wajib. If you lose it without an excuse, you might get some sins according to the Hanafi madhab. But according to the rest of the schools, it's very highly recommended. There is no sins if you miss Salat al-Watr. Each of these five prayers has its own certain time. And it has a time window that you pray. We call it in Usul al-Fiqh al-Wajib al-Muwassa. Wajib al-Muwassa means you have like the flexibility of establishing or performing the ibadah within like a kind of longer time. So that the dhuhr prayer, for example, can be prayed in a couple, 3 minutes, 5 minutes, right? But the time that you're allowed to pray Salat al-Fajr within, Salat al-Dhuhr within, might be like 3-4 hours, for example. This we call it the time. Within these 3-4 hours, you have the flexibility to pray the fard. But you are highly recommended to pray as soon as possible, specifically if you do not have an excuse. Okay, I delay it without an excuse, you lose tawab, but you're still good. As long as you prayed it within this time window. So let's say Salat al-Dhuhr is 1:30 adhan, and Salat al-Asr is like 5 adhan, right? So you have between 1:30 to 5 to pray Salat al-Dhuhr. If you pray at 1:30, 1:39, you get the highest level of thawab. Because as-salatu ala waqtiha, prayer at its time, as the Prophet ﷺ said. If you do it with jama'ah, you get extra thawab, right? Okay, I pray that at 2, it's okay. 2:30, 3, 3:30, 4, all that is okay. If you delay without an excuse, you lose thawab. If you delay with an excuse, maybe you still get the thawab as if you prayed it according to your capacity. Okay, Asr is at 5. I pray 4:45. It's okay. 4:50. It's almost okay. 4:55. You get in a karaha. Now it's really highly disliked to do this. Okay, 4:56. It's just 4 minutes before Asr. That's really makruh. That's very disliked. It's like you literally would say salam and then Asr Adhan is on. That's very makruh. Right. If it's 5, now you missed it. What does it mean that I missed it? I have to make it up, and there is a huge sin for it. It's a major sin that you do that. 5 o'clock comes, subhanAllah, like 4:59, you're good. 5 o'clock, it's a major sin. Unless there's an excuse, and there is no really, like, unless it's a really serious excuse for like for something related to your health, something related to whatever the excuse that you would come up with. But generally, you had the ability to do it, or you delayed it without a reason, it's a major sin to delay salah until the other salah time comes. So in page 21, he explained the times. How do we understand the times of each salah? According to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So for the noon prayer, for example, it begins with the sun passing its zenith. Zawal al-shams, we call it. This is the old way of understanding the times using the old like astronomy of the Arabs at that time. The mid-afternoon prayer, for example, begins when the length of an object's shadow minus its shadow at the zenith is greater than the object's height, and continues until the sunset. This is the way they would measure the time of Asr. Now we have calculations, we have watches and all this stuff. It's become just much easier than before. The sunset prayer, it's the sunset time, that's clear. The night prayer, when the red in the sky disappears and continues until the beginning of a true dawn. That's why the time for Isha is long. All the way until the Fajr, you can pray Isha. from the as you said, from the if you interested in these things, you can watch or observe some kind of redness in the sky. This is the, when the time of Isha begins. You can see in open big spaces. If you go outside Windsor, for example, and you try to watch like the big fields, you can watch and observe these things in the sky. There is a kind of a redness, humra, we call it, in the horizon. That's the time of Isha, and it goes all the way until the true dawn. He said true dawn because there is false dawn and true dawn. Right? And that's fiqhi terms. False doesn't mean something bad. It's just like al-fajr al-kadhib wa-sadiq. It's just like terms that the scholars made to differentiate between these two times. The dawn prayer begins at true dawn when there is a glow on the horizon. And it extends to the rising of the sun. إلى طلوع الشمس. And for the fajr, you have from the true dawn all the way to the sunrise. Once the sun rises, now you missed it. So these are the times of these five prayers. How do you get these things? It's the way that Jibreel came to the Prophet ﷺ and he led them in these five times, in these exact times. There was a famous hadith in Sahih Muslim that the Prophet ﷺ said, Jibreel came to me twice, two days in a row, and he led them. The Jibreel led the Prophet ﷺ in a jama'ah in these five times. And he repeated it in the second day to tell him this is exactly what we want people to pray, the way we want people to pray. So the fact that he repeated it two times for 2 days, that means this is the only way you have to pray this time. You have to pray these prayers. And then he told him in the second day, As-salatu al-waqtu ma bayna al-waqtayn. Like he said, the time of each prayer is between each two prayers. Right? Except for Fajr. Right? It's from the dawn, the true dawn, until the sunrise. But Dhuhr, it's until Asr. Asr, it's until Maghrib. Maghrib until Isha, Isha until Fajr. This is the time window of each prayer. The only one, the only exception is Salatul Fajr. And here he mentioned the full hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. At the end, as he told him, the time is between these two times. Between each two times, again, except for the Fajr. These are the like an introduction to the Salah. Then there are conditions of validity, as we call them, or prerequisites for your prayer to be accepted or to be valid. وَيَشْتَرَطُ لِصُحَّةِ الصَّلَاةِ مَعْرِفَةُ دُخُولِ الْوَقْتِ بِيَقِينٍ أَوْ اجْتِهَادٍ أَوْ غَلَبَةِ ظَنٍ فَإِنْ صَلَّى مَعَ الشَّكِّ لَمْ تَصِحَّ صَلَاتُهُ. So it is a condition for the validity of prayer to know the time has entered with certainty, which might mean seeing it, if you can observe these things. Second, reasoning, ijtihad, such as counting, or basically watches, or considering it most likely. And then he said, if one prays while being in doubt, his prayer is not valid. These three things he mentioned, you go with him by order, by the way. So you have to, if you can reach the level of certainty about the time, you have to do it. Okay, I can't, I'm in doubt. You go with ijtihad, with reasoning. If you cannot do that, you go with ghalabatul dhan. Most likely that's the time. Again, now alhamdulillah, Allah made things a lot easier for us by this technology and advancement of methods that we can use for calculation. But generally, you never know what situation you'll be and you want actually to think about the prayer times, or you want to make a kind of ijtihad to know if the time is on or not. You have to follow these steps. The last sentence he mentioned is very critical. He said, if you pray while being in doubt, your prayer will not be accepted. A scenario of this, if you wake up like almost at the end of the night, and then you think that it's time for Fajr, right? You want to pray. You got up, you made wudu, you didn't check your watch, and then you prayed. You were not sure if it's time or not. This doesn't count. If you were in doubt, this doesn't count. Okay, after I finish my prayer, I check the watch and it's already the time. No, you need to repeat it again. Why? Because when you started praying, you were in doubt. And you had a very easy means to check the time and you didn't do that. So the fact that it happened in time by coincidence doesn't make it right. Right? Did you get that? Because again, this is something you had the means to make sure that that's the time of the salah. This happens also in fasting, by the way, in siyam. Right? If you wake up and then you eat without checking the time, if it's Fajr time or not, it's the same problem. Or you think it's Maghrib time, it's sunset, and you start breaking your fast, and then it turns out that that's not the time for the sunset, you actually nullifies your fasting day. Talking about dhanb or sins, that's different. We're going to talk about this in the chapter of Siyam, inshallah. The point is, you make sure within the available means to you, it's not something that is beyond your capacity. Within the available means for you, you have to make sure that it's the time for the salah. So this is the first prerequisite. The second one, ma'rifatul qibla. It's a condition for the validity of prayer to know the direction of prayer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran, قد نرى تقلب وجهك في السماء فلنولينك قبلة ترضاها فولي وجهك شطر المسجد الحرام. Said we have seen the turning of the face of your face to heaven for guidance, because he was a little bit confused, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or he wished that Allah would give him the direction for the Qibla, the famous story. And then he said, and now verily we shall make you turn in prayer toward the Qibla, which is clear to you. So turn your face toward inviolable place of worship, Al-Masjid al-Haram. You know, the Qibla was towards Al-Masjid al-Aqsa before this ayah was revealed. Yeah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam what he wished in his heart. He used to wish in his heart that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him this special thing to face the Al-Masjid al-Haram or the Kaaba in his prayer. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith also, if you stand to pray, perform ablution properly and face the direction of prayer and say Allahu Akbar. So we understood from these texts that you have to face the Qibla. Okay, and a lot of times we get confused about the Qibla, right? And we all would use the phone apps or whatever, any campus app to know what is the direction of the Qibla. You need to put a little bit of effort for this too, right? If you are in doubt, if you do not really trust the app that you're using, if you trust the consistency of this app that every time gives you, like, some apps do that, right? It gives you some confusing direction sometimes. So you need to you're not required to do more than this, but more than checking your apps, but try to put some effort into relying on one of these really accurate apps, right? And if you're in doubt, do it a couple times. Use a couple apps or couple websites. There's no problem about this. But it's very important that you know this is most likely the right direction towards the Kaaba or the house of Allah subhanahu. There was a long discussion about facing the Qibla, because the scholars had an old disagreement that do we have to face the exact direction of the Kaaba or the general direction, that means it's Kaaba, it's that side of the world. That's a big discussion. So they said, do you have, it's Aynul Qibla, it's Aynul Kaaba, so that means you have to the exact angle of the direction of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there, or is that side, if it's like between north and east, for example, as we say here in Windsor, that means like whatever in that direction will be the Qibla. And it's a very important khilaf, because that means if the Qibla is this way, for example, and we say it's north and east, that means I can pray this, like a little slight of the angle wouldn't be a big problem. But if you have to face the exact angle of the Qibla, that means I have to make sure that's the exact angle that I have to pray towards. Of course, all of them said, if you have the means to do it exactly, you have to do it exactly. You are really recommended to do it exactly. But some of them said, Jihatul Qibla, Jiha means like this direction in general, not the exact angle, is enough. So, no, they had a very accurate ways of, that's not about having the means. Of course, we had more advanced things, but they had also very smart about these things. Even the what you call them, the illiterate people during the Arab time, they were very smart about directions, by the way. But the point is to make things easy for people, because not all people will share the knowledge of these things. But now we have this advancement of technology, but we still have these discussions here in North America, by the way. We have a lot of discussions about deciding what is the exact angle towards the Kaaba or the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it also depends on the way you conceptualize the earth, right? The way you draw the planet in your mind, or scientifically, and the way you draw the directions, east and west and north and south, that's also another discussion. Like Mecca or Saudi Arabia now, is it like south, west, east? Like, there is a lot of discussions about these things. But generally, the discussion stems from the fact that do we have to face the exact angle or not? That's the point behind these discussions. The third prerequisite for salah is satr al-awra. ويجب ستر العورة بساتر طاهر مباح. It is obligatory to cover one's nakedness with a cover that is pure and permissible. So what is the awra? That's very important. What is the awra in the salah? It depends. It's different between a male and a female, a man and a woman. An adult male must cover the area between his navel and his knees. The Prophet ﷺ said, a believer's nakedness is what lies between the navel and his knees. ﷺ. And the hadith is referring to the man, because he taught about women in another hadith. That's for the man. For a woman, an adult female must cover everything besides her face and hands. This is what was indicated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا. The famous ayah in Surah An-Nur. Do not display of their adornment only that which is apparent. And in this verse, adornment refers to the parts of the body that usually women put adornments in, which is mainly the face and the hands. The Prophet ﷺ also said in the hadith, the prayer of a woman who has reached the age of menstruation is not accepted without a head covering. He's talking about the salah. Akhimar, as he said in the hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And a lot of other hadith, and he mentioned here multiple examples that the Prophet ﷺ was talking about the awrah and how to cover the awrah of both males and females. The fourth prerequisite is the najasa. وَيَجِبُ رَفْعُ النَّجَاسَةِ مِنَ الثَّوْبِ وَالْبَدَنِ وَالْمَكَانِ. It is obligatory to remove filth from the clothes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ. And your raiment, your garment, purify. In Surah Al-Muddathir. So your clothes, your body, and the place of the prayer. These three things, you have to make sure that they are pure. The body, the Prophet ﷺ said, remove urine, since most of the torture in the grave comes from it. And here comes back to the point I mentioned earlier, that we take these things seriously, because this is as important as the Prophet ﷺ explained. And he mentioned the hadith that we mentioned already. The Prophet once passed by two graves, and he said, these two persons are being tortured, and it is not for a major sin. One of them never saved himself from being soiled with his urine, while the other used to go about with calumnies, like namima, like be fallen between people. And then the Prophet ﷺ, look at the mercy of the Prophet ﷺ. After he said that to his companions, he didn't just like leave those people. Because of his mercy and love, he took a green date palm leaf, and he split it and placed on each grave one of these leaves of the palm trees. And the Sahab asked him, why did you do this? He asked the Prophet ﷺ, why did you do that? Why do you put these green leaves on the graves? And he said, I hope their punishment might be lessened till these pieces of the leaf become dry. So as long as they are green, maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show his mercy and those people and make their punishments less than what they are already suffering from. Also, the place that you are praying in, you have to make sure it's pure. There was this famous incident when the Sahaba were in the masjid, and then a Bedouin man came because he didn't understand the etiquettes of that place. He started urinating in the mosque with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And people got so upset, and they went to stop him, to grab him. The Prophet said, no, leave him alone. And he left him until he finished, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is also out of his mercy and out of his understanding of the different cultures of people too. Because the man didn't do that out of rudeness. He really didn't know. I mean, to us in our culture, that's very rude. Doesn't matter if it's a mosque or a house or any building. But for that man, that's his culture. Right? It's just like a dry, open space. To him, it's as simple as this. It's just a person that he's never experienced anything in his life except just living in a tent. So he understood his culture, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he didn't really rebuke the man. He actually told the Sahaba, don't interrupt him. That's bad. Do not. When somebody is doing the act, you can't interrupt him because you're actually causing him harm. If not physically, it's like even emotionally, you cannot interrupt him. They left him until he finished. And then he asked the Sahaba, just bring a bucket of water and just pour it on the place that he prayed in. And he urinated in. And that's it. He said, دَعُوهُ أَرِيقُ عَلَيْهِ ذَنُوبًا مِمَّا صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then he looked at his companions and he wanted to teach them a lesson. Now we got the first lesson that you have to purify the place you're praying in. Because if it wasn't a filth or a najasa, you wouldn't have done that, so, right? You wouldn't have asked them to pour some water there. So we understood that number one, filth is a najasa. You cannot pray in a place that is full of filth. Number two, you understood that urine is a filth and it's a najasa. Number three, you understood that the only way you clean a najasa is using water. And we mentioned that last time. These three things we derive from the hadith. Then the fourth thing is the spiritual meaning of this hadith is what the Prophet ﷺ told the companions at the end. He told them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُمْ مُيَسَّرِينَ وَلَمْ تُبْعَثُوا مُعَسِّرِينَ. He said, you have been sent to make things easy, not to make them difficult. This is the purpose of honoring the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ over the rest of the nations of the ummah. Those are the main prerequisites of the salah. And the last thing that you can count as a prerequisite, or actually it's better to count it as one of the pillars of the salah, and we mentioned that last time, is وَيَجِبُ عَلَى الْقَادِرِ أَنْ يُصَلِّيَ الْفَرْضَ قَائِمًا. It is obligatory for those who are able to stand to do so while praying the obligatory prayer. The Prophet ﷺ said to Imran ibn Husayn, one of his companions, pray while standing. If you cannot, then pray sitting. If you cannot, then pray lying on your side. Another version, he said, and if you are not able, then on your back. If you're not able to lie down, then on your side, then on your back. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wouldn't task if not a soul beyond its scope. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala task if not a soul beyond its scope. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah wouldn't command you something that is beyond your capacity. So you can do all these things. But the condition is you do not move from a position to another position until you make sure that you're not able to do the one first. Right? If you cannot stand, you're okay to sit down. If you cannot sit down, you're okay to lie on your side. If you cannot, you're okay to lie on your back. Right? The main thing you understood from this is that there is no excuse you can skip praying. Right? Even if you're lying on your back. The whatever you are able to move from your body in terms of the a'da, the limbs of the prayer, you have to move. Even sometimes you say a person can pray with his eyes if this is the only part that he can move. Sometimes a person can pray with his heart. If he's completely like paralyzed, he cannot move any part, he can pray with his heart. As long as he is mindful of what he's doing. If he loses his mind, he's not mukallaf, he's not responsible. But if he's still like aware of what he's doing, but he cannot control his body, he has to pray. That's the main lesson out of this, that you have to pray. You cannot skip praying. But there's something interesting about this sentence that he mentioned here. He said, it is obligatory for those who are able to stand to do so while praying the obligatory prayer. Does that mean if it's not an obligatory prayer, we are actually allowed to sit down? Yes? So there are 2 points here. The first point is, if I'm not able to stand, I can sit down. Whether it's obligatory or, of course, if it's a recommended prayer, right? Okay. If I'm able to stand, I'm not allowed to sit down. If it is an obligatory prayer. This is what we understood. Okay. I'm able to stand. That's another scenario. I'm able to stand, but I don't want to stand. I want to just sit down praying Taraweeh. Now Ramadan is close, and some people just prefer to sit while praying Taraweeh. Or Duha, or Watr, whatever are the recommended prayers. Am I allowed to do this? What? According to this, yes. Yes, so the answer is yes. You can sit down, even if you're able to stand. But you get less tawab. You get less reward. But your prayer is okay. So again, I'm praying Taraweeh, I'm praying Qiyam al-Layl, I'm praying Tahajjud. It's long prayer. I cannot stand for all that long. I want to sit down. I really can. I physically can stand, but I just like feel like sitting, basically. It doesn't have to be a real excuse, by the way. You do not have to have a knee problem or a feet problem to do this. You have the option to pray while sitting, if it's a recommended prayer, if it's not a fard prayer, right? But again, if you are able, but you just choose to pray while sitting, you get less tawab. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Salatul rajuli qa'idan nisfu salah." Said when a man or a woman, when he prays or she prays while sitting, that's a half prayer. Half prayer in terms of the tawab. The prayer is fine. The prayer is valid, but you just get less tawab, right? The other point is, this also would apply to while you are on a plane, train, in your car, right? Can you pray while sitting in these things? So now I'm traveling by my car. Whether I'm like the first scenario is I'm not driving, but I'm in a car. And I want to pray duha. I want to pray sunnah after duhur, or whatever. These sunnah are like associated with the 5 obligatory prayers. Can I do them while I'm sitting in the car? No.
Yes.
Okay, what if it's a fard? What? Okay, so we have 2 scenarios now. It's one of the obligatory prayers or it's a recommended prayer. If it is a fard prayer, dhuhr, asr, maghrib, and I'm driving or I'm actually the in the passenger seat and I want to pray. Can I pray in the car?
No. Yes. No.
What?
It can be moving.
The scenario is the car is moving, of course. So can we pray?
Yeah, if you can't stop.
What would prevent you from stopping?
Maybe you're traveling in the train.
What?
In the train.
In the train, okay, I'm talking about a car now. Because it's gonna matter. So let's talk about the car first. I'm in the car, that's the scenario. I'm in the car. Okay, just have one conversation. So I'm in the car and I'm in the passenger seat. I'm gonna give all the details so you just understand the scenario. I'm in the passenger seat, someone else is driving, and it's a dhuhr prayer. And the car is moving. Can I pray dhuhr?
Yes.
Okay, so the answer is no. Okay? Just to make it short. So the farad, no. You cannot pray farad in a moving vehicle. You can't. Okay, because simply you can just pull over and pray. And it's not a rukhsa. It's not a dispensation, as you call it in fiqh. It's not something that the Prophet allowed it to do. He would stop and pray. If it's a sunnah, yes. And here you're allowed to skip 2 things. You're allowed to skip that you have to stand, and you're allowed to skip the qibla too. The Prophet on his camel or on his horse, he would pray. Whatever the horse or the camel is moving, he would just pray. Sunnah. These two things you're allowed to skip in your sunnah prayer while in your car. So I'm in the car, I want to just pray again. Any sunnah. I'm traveling at night, I just want to pray Qiyam al-Layl. You can pray Qiyam al-Layl in the car. That's okay. And you can skip these two things. As long as it's not a fard prayer, you can do that. If it's fard, no, you can't. Okay. What? Yeah, what do you mean it's not safe? No, I think you can. In Canada, you can. Let's talk about Canada. In Canada, you can. The only maybe scenario that is a little bit tough is in the plane. When you are on a plane, yeah, that's now tough. You cannot go anywhere. You cannot stop the plane and pray, right? So you have now two scenarios. Some planes, you can actually stand and pray, right? So if you go for Umrah, for example, and you book the Saudi Airlines, they have a place and they have the Qibla and everything. It's ready. They have like a small, not a real musalla, but like a space that takes two people or three people. And you have a Qibla, you have a compass that you can get the Qibla. Some airlines companies, they have that. If you do it like this, you're fine. Okay, I can't. I'm not. I'm in Lufthansa Airlines and the flight is full of people. I cannot move. Now you pray while you're sitting. That's an exception. But there is an ikhtilaf. This is an important point. There is an ikhtilaf. Do I have to redo this prayer or not? And my personal advice, yes, pray them again. This doesn't happen that often. When you reach the place, and the maximum number of prayers you would miss, maybe two, three maximum, but it's not going to be more than three prayers most of the times. So when you miss three prayers, you pray them on time in the salah, on the plane, I mean, because this is the only option that you have, right? You cannot do more than this. لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا. There is no dhamb, there is no sin. Now you skip a lot of things, but it's okay. But you have to pray because it's the time for prayer, and you as if you're showing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I do what I can do. When you reach that place, at your convenience, make up these prayers again. Right? Not that those prayers didn't really count, but just to make sure that I'm redoing these prayers again, just to make sure that I'm perfecting those prayers. Some scholars said, no, you don't have to do this because that was your capacity. It's okay. But again, that's my opinion, is that it's better to repeat these prayers again. Because this scenario doesn't really happen every single day most of the times. So you actually can do it. And sometimes you can avoid even that because you have the rukhsa of combining prayers. Right? Sometimes you can pray in the airport, for example, and now you got two prayers, or when you reach one of the stops, you can. There's a lot of things, but you need to put effort to schedule these things. Right? Because a lot of times, you get a question like, okay, I cannot stop the car, but you cannot schedule your trip. Right? You can easily schedule it that, okay, there's a stop at that place, or there's a stop on this en route, for example, I'm going to stop and I'm going to try to pray somewhere. Because it's part of your planning. If you're planning your trip, if it's a work trip, if it's a fun trip, whatever the trip you're going for, part of your plan has to be your prayers. I'm making sure that I'm going to pray Dhuhr and Asr, combining, for example, in that place. And then I'm going to pray Maghrib and Isha in that place. So it's not that hard, but we just need to put some effort into praying. Again, fard prayer, okay, we'll get the questions at the end, I'm sorry. Fard prayers, you cannot pray them on a vehicle, on a moving vehicle, you have to stop and pray them. Sunnah, yes. And you are allowed to skip the Qibla, and you are allowed to skip standing in the prayer. Okay, let's have a general description of all the acts of the Salah. There is one famous hadith from the Prophet ﷺ in which he explained in detail all the acts of the Salah. It's a very famous hadith reported in the Sahih. That one day a man came and entered the Prophet's mosque ﷺ, and he started praying. And the Prophet ﷺ was sitting and he watched the man while he was praying. And then after the man is done, he came to the Prophet ﷺ and he greeted him. He gave salam to the Prophet ﷺ. So the first thing the Prophet told him is that go back and pray again because you didn't pray. ارجع فصلي فإنك لم تصلي. So go back and redo your prayer because that you didn't pray basically. So the man went back and he tried to pray again. And then he came to give salam to the Prophet. And he told him like, go back and pray. You didn't pray. And then he came to the Prophet. That's the third time. And he gave him salam. He said, go back and pray because you didn't pray. For three times. So the man said, Ya Rasulullah, wallahi, I cannot do more than this. I cannot do better than this. That's what I can do. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he explained to him in detail how to pray. This is the main hadith that we derived all the obligatory acts of the Salah from. Because he was teaching him the essentials. Almost every single thing he mentioned in this hadith is essential in the Salah. He was counting the obligatory acts. Because the man doesn't know. Maybe he was a new Muslim. He was someone who has never learned about Salah. So he explained the obligatory acts of this man. We call it in Arabic, hadith al-musi'i salatahu, or al-musi'i fi salatihi. A person who didn't know how to perfect and how to perform his prayer. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told him, when you get up for the prayer, perform the ablution properly. Now he is counting the obligations. And then face the Qibla and say, Allahu Akbar. And then recite what is easy for you from the Quran. And we're going to get back to this sentence. And then bow until you repose in bowing. This word of reposing is very important too. So you need to just highlight this word. And then raise your head and stand straight. And then prostrate until you repose in prostration. And then sit up until you repose in sitting. And then prostrate again until you repose in prostration. And then rise and stand straight. And do all this in all your prayers. So he basically explained to him one raka'ah in detail. And then he said, you just can do the same thing in the rest of the raka'ahs. Those are the integrals that have to be performed in each prayer. Because the hadith is explaining only the integrals and the foundations. And the hadith used the word thumma, and then. And so he was counting the obligations in that order, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to that man. So we derive from this hadith the obligatory acts of the salah. The first thing is al-niyyah. As we said in the wudu, you have the intention to pray. The intention is the first obligation of the salah. نَمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ As the Prophet ﷺ said, actions are according to the intentions. The niyyah is important, whether you are praying by yourself, you're praying in a jama'ah, you're praying as an imam, you're praying as as someone who's following an imam, it doesn't matter. You have to have intention for your prayer. If the prayer is obligatory, you have to specify the prayer that you are praying in your intention. So you have to say, you have to, I mean, to be mindful that I'm praying dhuhr, I'm praying asr, I'm praying ma'. You have to specify. You cannot just say, I intend to pray. Right? That's not a niyyah. You have to specify the. We said last time, a main purpose of the niyyah is that you distinguish between the prayer and another prayer, or ibadah, and another ibadah. If it's a recommended prayer, the same thing. So you have the intention of praying duha, an intention of praying watr, an intention of praying one of these sunnah that are associated with the prayers, for example. You have to specify in your intention the type or the kind of prayer that you are performing. We said last time that intention is in the heart, right? You be mindful of your of the ibadah you're performing in your heart. If you want to utter your intention just to, as you said, to help your heart, to help yourself be more mindful, you can say that. But this doesn't really matter a lot. The main thing is that you have to be mindful of the prayer that you are praying. So this is the first thing. An-niyyah, the first fard in the salah. And then after that, takbiratul ihram. This is the second obligation of the salah. The opening takbira. You say Allahu Akbar. Concurrent to the intention. You have the intention, in the same time you are saying Allahu Akbar. Call it takbiratul ihram. The word ihram is derived from the word haram. Right? Prohibition. And the meaning, the reason it was called ihram, because whatever was lawful for you before this word is not going to be lawful anymore. Because you are restricted now. This is one of the reasons why it was called al-ihram. Because, for example, you cannot eat while you're praying, you cannot talk, you cannot drink. There's a lot of things that you are restricted from doing once you start praying. So that's why we call it takbiratu al-ihram. So the Prophet ﷺ said, miftahu hat-takbir. Its opening is Allahu Akbar. You say Allahu Akbar. So this is the second obligation. The third obligation, قِرَاءَةُ الْفَاتِحَةِ بِالْبَسْمَلَةِ وَالتَّشْدِيدَاتِ الْأَرْبَعِ عَشَرَةِ وَإِخْرَاجِ الضَّادِ مِنَ الضَّاءِ وَلَيْسَ فِي الْفَاتِحَةِ ضَاءٍ. Then the third obligation is that reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. The Prophet ﷺ said, لَا صَلَاةَ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَأْ بِفَاتِحَةِ الْكِتَابِ. A prayer wherein the person didn't recite Fatiha Al-Kitab is not sufficient. Which means, according to the majority of scholars, that your prayer is going to be invalid if you do not recite Surah Al-Fatiha. And also the man who said, the Prophet ﷺ told the man, if you remember that hadith, the man who didn't know how to pray, told him, read what you can read from the Quran. He used the word mentioned in the ayah, فَقْرَأُوا مَا تَيَسَّرَ مِنْ. Read what you know, read what is easy to you to read. But in a lot of other ahadith, he specified this part of the Quran to be Surah Al-Fatiha. So we understood that Surah Al-Fatiha is a must. And the other part of the Quran that you recite after Al-Fatiha is just recommitted. This the way we understood that Fatiha is actually a must in the Salah. Then he said the Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, is an ayah from Surah Al-Fatiha. That's an ikhtilaf among the scholars, but a lot of scholars said it's an ayah from Al-Fatiha. You have to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim at the beginning of Surah Al-Fatiha because it's counted as an ayah from Surah Al-Fatiha. And you have to understand that Surah Al-Fatiha, you have to do your best to recite it properly. Which means you have to know how to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. You have to learn the basic tajweed of Surah Al-Fatiha. You have to. You have to means it's a fard on you to do that. Because if it's a fard on your prayer, that means it's a fard on you to learn how to recite it. That's why if you noticed, he said, for example, and it's 14 double letters. He counted them. التشديدات. To tell you, you cannot miss one of those. You know, حرف المشدد, the double letters. If like ربي, and the word ربي العالمين. If you didn't say ربي with the باء مشدد, that might invalidate your prayer. Right? الرحمن الرحيم. This is the تشديد, the double letters in الراء. You have to say it this way. He indicates here that you have to learn how to recite Surah Al-Fatiha properly. Some people have problems with pronunciation. Some people have problems with Arabic language. Some people have these excuses. Yes, but they have to try to do that as much as they can. Not the perfect and the master level of tajweed, but at least all the letters can be uttered or pronounced in the most proper way. And they have to learn how to do this. Whether Arab, non-Arab, it doesn't matter. Surah Al-Fatiha is the least. You have to learn from the Quran how to recite them. 7 verses is not that long. It doesn't really take that long time to learn how to recite it. You have to make sure that you memorize it, and then you recite it properly. That's something that's part of the obligations of Surah Al-Fatiha. He even said that there is no dha in Al-Fatiha. He's talking about these detailed things to tell you have to learn these things. So if you said wala dhalin instead of saying wala dhalin, that's wrong, and this might invalidate your prayer. Unless you are in the process of learning, you are just in the process of learning. You cannot be, I'm sorry, you cannot be like a 25 old Muslim who was born and raised a Muslim and say, I'm still learning how to recite a Fatiha. That's not an excuse, right? When we're saying there's an excuse for some people, somebody who is still just a new Muslim, for example, yes, that's a real serious excuse. Or someone who has never got a chance in his life to learn Surah Al-Fatiha, which is very odd to happen. But if that's the case, you still are responsible for this. You have to make sure you learn this. Maybe that was your circumstances, you didn't know how to recite it. That's okay. But now you realize that it's a responsibility upon me, not upon anyone else, because I'm an adult person. I'm a mukallaf, I'm responsible. I have to know how to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. The reason he taught about the tashdidat, the double letters, the dha and the dha, because some of these mistakes might change the meaning. Saying walad dhalin is completely different than walad dhalin, by the way. Right? These are two different words. Because a dhalin means, who knows what a dhalin means? What? Baqi, it's derived from dhalla. Dhalla means to remain, to stay. So walad dhalin means those who stayed. The ayah doesn't talk about this. Dhalin is from misguidance, it's from dhalala. The people are misguided. It's completely different meanings. One letter changes the whole meaning. That's the point about Surah Al-Fatiha. And then the ruku', thumma ruku', and then bowing. And that's, of course, an ijma', a consensus of all the scholars. It is obligatory to bend until one's palms can reach one's knees, reposing such that one's limbs come to a rest. Viewing is obligatory too. This is very important. At-tuma'nina. If you notice in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, in every certain obligation in prayer, he said, and then repose doing this. Reposing means at-tuma'nina means you take a little bit your time doing this. Okay, you know those people who just pray like very fast. They just literally bow for like even a slight angle and then they raise again. This doesn't count. The minimum, the least, is you rest your body in the position of the rukun of the obligation for at least as long as you say Subhanallah. This is the minimum. Subhanallah, the time I took saying this is the minimum. After you already are in the, you are already in the position of the ruku' or in the sujood or any other part of the salah. Less than this doesn't count. If somebody does like this, no, this doesn't count as a ruku'. This is not ruku', this is not considered. And even if he continues the prayer, the whole prayer is invalid because that's not ruku'. So this is the minimum. I don't know how long is Subhanallah, 1 second, 2 seconds. This is the least. You're recommended to do more, of course, but this is the least. This is the minimal that you can do in your prayer. Then rising, ثم الاعتدال ويطمئن فيه وجوبا. The same thing. He has to repose in that, which is an obligatory thing. The Prophet ﷺ, when he told that person he didn't know how to pray, said, then rise until you stand upright, which means like you are already in that position of standing. Reposing therein is obligatory. Then prostrating twice and sitting between the prostrations. And that's, of course, an ijma'. And then reposing is obligatory during them all, during all these different actions in the salah. And then one performs the remaining prayer cycles the same. What was just explained in this rak'ah, you repeat in all the other rak'ahs. Then he thought about the tashahud. And we have two tashahuds in the salah. We had the middle or the first, al-awwal or al-awsat, and the last or the second. Said the first tashahud and sitting for it are recommended. That, of course, would happen in any prayer that consists of 3 or 4 rak'ahs, right? 2 rak'ahs is just one tashahud. The Prophet ﷺ once stood during the noon prayer while he was supposed to sit for tashahud. He was praying dhuhr, leading the companions. After the second rak'ah, he didn't sit down for the tashahud and he just stood up. And he continued and he finished his prayer this way and he didn't do anything else. He just offered the two rak'ahs of the two sajdas of sahu. He offered two prostrations at the end, which another part of the fiqh of prayer that basically kind of you make up for some things that you miss in the salah. Not for everything, but for certain things you miss in your salah, you can offer two prostrations at the end and this would make up for the thing that you missed. One of these things that you miss in your prayer is the first tashahud. Sujood al-sahu, that's a different chapter in prayer, but these two prostrations, they only make it up for things that are recommended, not that are must. If you miss ruku', if you miss sujood, bowing or prostration, if you miss reading al-fatiha, you cannot say, okay, I'm going to offer two sajdas. No. You have to repeat it. But if you miss some kinds of recommended actions, like the first tashahud, yes, you can make it up while you are, because it's a sunnah. So you sit down for the first tashahud, that's a sunnah. You say the tashahud, that's a sunnah. You offer salah or send prayers or supplications upon the Prophet ﷺ is a sunnah in this tashahud. While the final tashahud and sitting for it are obligatory. This is the last one. Because the Prophet ﷺ, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said, before the tashahud was made obligatory, so he used that word, which means it became obligatory. We used to say, peace be upon Allah before his servants. Peace be upon Jibreel. Peace be upon Mika'il, one of the angels of Allah. Peace be upon so and so. And then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do not say peace be upon Allah. Because Allah is peace himself. Inna Allah huwa salam. Rather say all greetings to Allah. And then he taught them the actual form of tashahud, which we know now, at-tahiyyatu lillah, and he's going to mention it in a bit. In that last tashahud, praying upon the Prophet ﷺ after the tashahud and before saying assalamu alaikum is obligatory. It's obligatory. If you miss saying Allahumma salli ala Muhammad in your tashahud, in your last one, that invalidates your salah. It's a fard in your tashahud. And then wassalamu min as-salati fardun, saying assalamu alaikum to exit from prayer is obligatory too. The minimal salam or the minimal exit salam is assalamu alaikum. Or you could say assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. But if you say assalamu alaikum, that should be enough. When you say the point of a tashahud al-awwal, the first tashahud, it's a sunnah. That means if you miss it, you can just offer these two prostrations, right? If you stand up after the second rak'ah because you forgot to sit down, do not go back. Now you finish your second rak'ah, you stood up already. Then, oh, I didn't do the second tashahud. Do not sit down to do it. Khalas, just move on. Actually, if you go back to it, you invalidate your prayer. You cannot go back to it. You are not allowed to go back to it. Why? The reasoning behind this is that you left or you moved from sunnah to a fard. You cannot go back from fard to a sunnah. That confuses people a lot in the mosque, right? When an imam does this and people try to correct the imam saying subhanAllah, it's okay to say subhanAllah because you need to remind him that you missed something. But the imam has to know that he cannot go back. That's why people should just say subhanAllah. If the imam doesn't go back, subhanAllah, khalas, he knows. But don't keep saying subhanAllah because he already knows that he did a mistake. But he cannot go back, right? If he stands up, he can't. Because it's already, he moved from a sunnah to a fard, do not go back. Then at the end of the salah, he offers these two prostrations, which is sujood al-sahw. And by the way, if you join a jama'ah, and you find the imam offering two sajdas for something that he missed, even if you don't know what happened, you have to go to follow him. Let's say you join the jama'ah din, and after the tashahud, the imam is offering two sajdas. You say, I don't know what they did. It's okay, just follow him. Because you joined the jama'ah. You cannot say, I wasn't part of his mistake, so I shouldn't follow. No, you just follow the imam until he makes salam, and then you continue your salah. He mentioned the tashahud, the obligatory tashahud, the minimal obligatory tashahud. التحيات لله سلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته سلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله. This part is obligatory to memorize because it's as al-Fatiha. If you are obliged to memorize al-Fatiha, you're obliged to memorize al-Tahiyyat. Because it's anything that is obligatory in the salah, you have to learn and memorize. So if it's a saying, if something that you say, you have to memorize. And the only two sayings in the prayer is al-Fatiha and the tashahud. These are the two things that you have to memorize. And he mentioned the translation for the dua. And the minimal supplication upon the Prophet ﷺ is Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. This is the least, the minimal. And then if you want the full, you offer as-salatu al-Ibrahimi, as we call it. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. He mentioned them here in detail and he mentioned the whole translation of the dua. Those are the obligations of the salah. When we said, we differentiated before between the obligations and the recommitted acts. Those are the obligations, starting from an-niyya until assalamu alaikum, right? If you miss any of these things that we just mentioned, your salah is invalid. And there are a lot of other recommitted acts that you are recommitted to know as well. He said one should perform all of the recommitted actions of prayer, and they are very numerous. And then the translator, he mentioned a few examples of the sunnah. There are a lot of sunnah in the salah. So the first sunnah you do in your salah is raising your hands when you're saying Allahu Akbar. This is the first sunnah. While you're saying Allahu Akbar to start your praying, you raise your hand. How can you raise your hand in the prayer? There are multiple ways of doing that, right? So that's a right way. What else? And that's a right way, and that's a right way. There are a lot of different ways that all mentioned in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the general rule is that some scholars, like in the Shafi'i school, they said, whatever way you do it is going to be counted as sunnah. But if you do the exact one that was mentioned in the hadith, that would be actually better thawab. But angel, any rafa, you say any raising, that would be considered as rafa. Call it rafa, like raising your hands in the prayer. But there are certain ways that were mentioned, reported from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is the first one. And the second sunnah, placing the right hand over the left. And you try to hold the rest of your left hand like this. And you put it between the chest and the navel. The third one is the opening supplication, dua al-istiftah. So say Allahu Akbar. So saying Allahu Akbar is a must. Raising your hand is a sunnah. Right? So do not confuse both. Because if you don't say Allahu Akbar, you didn't start your prayer doesn't count, by the way. So the saying of Allahu Akbar is the must. Raising the hand is sunnah. If you do not raise your hand and say Allahu Akbar and you start like this, you're good. You missed the sunnah, but you're good. But if you raise your hands and you didn't say Allahu Akbar, you didn't start your prayer. You didn't even start praying. So saying is a must. Raising the hands is a sunnah. Placing right hand over the left, that's a sunnah. And then saying the dua al-istiftah, or the opening supplication. The preferred one is وَجَّهْتُ وَجْهِيَ الَّذِي فَطَرَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ حَنِيفًا وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ اللهم أنت الملك لا إله إلا أنت وأنا عبدك. When he mentioned the translation of this dua, if you cannot memorize all of this, that's a sunnah. If you cannot memorize all this, the shorter supplication is الله أكبر كبيرة والحمد لله كثيرة وسبحان الله بكرة وأصيلة. That's the shorter way of saying the opening dua in the salah. Number four of the sunan, al-isti'adah, saying أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. So al-fatiha is a must. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is a verse of Al-Fatiha, right? But A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajeem, before you start reciting Al-Fatiha, is a sunnah, is a recommended action in the prayer. The number 5 and 6 together is as Israru wal-Jahr in the prayer. There are some prayers that you need to be using some audible utterances, and some other prayers, some quiet utterances. So Fajr, Maghrib, Isha, you recite a little bit out loud. Dhuhr, Asr, you recite just kind of like we call it sir, like secretly you're reciting. But see, if you notice, he used here the word audible utterances. Because if you recite sir, that means you have to recite. But other people do not hear you necessarily, but you can hear yourself. So it is not enough that you just are reading by your mind. If you're not moving your tongue and lips and you're actually reading, this doesn't count. So if you're just standing like this and you're just thinking of Surah Al-Fatiha, even if all the verses, actually you are thinking of all the verses, this doesn't count. Because reading qira'ah means you are actually reading something. So when you say sir, that doesn't mean that you're not basically doing anything. You're reading and you can hear yourself. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. You can do that in a bit, maybe a little bit more quiet than this, but you can hear yourself. You're actually reciting something. This is the concept of sir. That's number one. Number two, it doesn't matter you are in a jama'ah or not. If you're praying Maghrib by yourself, you're praying Isha by yourself, you're still recommended to raise your voice. So the concept of Jahr doesn't only apply to the Jama'ah, it applies to the Munfarid, to the individual too. But of course, like not really out loud, but he can raise his voice or her voice a little bit over the rest of the prayers that he just recite in a kind of a more quiet way. This happens in the first two rak'ahs of the Jahri, or the out loud prayers like Maghrib and Isha and Fajr. Number 7, saying Ameen at the end of Surah Al-Fatiha. And there is a lot of thawab you get from this. The Prophet said in the Jama'ah specifically, if you're saying Ameen, and the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the same time, they are saying Ameen too. And if you say it the same time the angels are saying it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And this, by the way, the only action in the jama'ah that you do with the imam. The only act in the jama'ah that you do with the imam. All the other acts in the jama'ah, you wait until the imam does it and then you do it after him. Right? The only one that you do in the same time, concurrent with the imam, is saying ameen, because you both say ameen at the same time. Number 8, you recite some part of the Quran after reciting Al-Fatiha. That's a sunnah, that's not a must. Okay, which is better, to recite one surah, like a short surah, or like a part of a long surah? Short surah, why?
You said it before.
I said that before? I don't remember I said that before, but okay.
No.
Okay. Here or somewhere else?
I don't know.
Oh, okay. Right. So, there is actually, there is ikhtilaf about this, but some scholars said if you recite one surah, it's better, the concept of betterment is just more thawab, basically. It's better to recite one surah than recite like 5-6 verses of another surah. Some scholars said no. It actually depends on the number of words and letters, because this is the hadith said, the more you read, the more you get thawab. So it doesn't matter if it's a surah or not, because short surah might be 4 or 5 verses, but a part of other surah might be 15-20 verses, for example. So of course, you should get more thawab if you read more than this. Number 9, saying Allahu Akbar, when you're going down in the ruku', when you're going down in the sujood, when you're raising from sujood, all of these actions except one. All these moves, you say Allahu Akbar except one. What is it? From what? Yes. From ruku', yes. What do we say? سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمْدًا. When you raise from ruku', you say سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمْدًا. But the rest of the moves, you say Allahu Akbar. And that's a sunnah, saying Allahu Akbar. So the only, like, obligatory Allahu Akbar is Al-Ihram, the first one, when you start your prayer. And the rest are just sunnah. Number 11, you say Subhana Rabbiya Al-Azim in your ruku' 3 times. And you say Subhana Rabbiya Al-A'la in your sujood 3 times. Can we say more than 3? Yes, but try, it's better to stick to an odd number if you go over 3, like 5, 7, that's the sunnah. And then number 12 is the way we put our hands and our legs or thighs while we are in the tashahhud. So the way we do that, in short, is that your left hand is just like this on your thighs. You don't do anything, just you stretch all your fingers like this. But the right will be in a different position. So you will basically do like this and put your thumb on the index like this, and you keep it down, okay? And then you start saying at-tahiyyatu lillahi wa barakatuh salawat, and you say all your tahiyyat. It's like this on your thighs, on your thigh, on your right one, okay? And you exactly like what I'm doing. And then once you reach ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, when you say la ilaha illallah, you raise your finger like this, not very sharp, but like exactly like this, and you keep it raised all the way until the end of the tashahhud. Until you're saying assalamu alaikum, or until you're raising for the third rak'ah if it's in the middle of the tashahhud. There are other ways of doing it because there are multiple hadith, but this is one of the authentic ones that is adopted by the Shafi'i school of thought. Some people do moves, right? But according to this school, you do not move it. Just raise it and just keep it like this. You do not move it. Moving is not wrong, but I'm saying that's one of the authentic ways of doing it. Okay, number 13 and 14 is the position of sitting in the tashahhud. So the problem about this, I cannot demonstrate it now because I'm just lazy to get up and do it. And I don't want to sit on the ground. So there are a little bit different between the... No, not because I'm lazy, because of the camera, so I cannot do it. So that's a better excuse, right? So there are different. The first tashahhud is different than the last tashahhud, right? We call the first one, we call it at-tawarruk. And the second one, we call it al-iftirash. They're close to each other, but you can read actually the detailed description as he mentioned here. I don't think we should actually spend time explaining it because he explained it very well here. You can read it carefully. Page 34. The first paragraph of page 34. They're a little bit close to each other. And then while you are praying, you can ask some people who know how to do it and you can actually watch them doing it and it's going to be easy to learn. It's not really a big deal. The last and the 15th one is saying the second assalamu alaikum. Because the first one is a must. The second one is not. The first, assalamu alaikum, that's the obligatory one. The second one is sunnah. You still do it, but it's a sunnah. Right? So if you say assalamu alaikum, you didn't see the second one for any reason, that's okay. Your prayer actually is okay. The beautiful thing is that the Sheikh here, he added in the middle of all these ahkam, he added like a small paragraph talking about some meaning, some spiritual meanings behind the salah. He said, one should pay attention to have sincerity, ikhlas. It is performing acts solely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the definition of ikhlas or sincerity. That you do all these things only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you notice, if you want to have one common link between all these acts, is that how much submission you show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, we said that before, I'm going to talk about it more in the last section of spirituality, that all these ahkam have to be reflected in spirituality. It's very important to perfect the fiqh rulings, but if you can master and perfect the fiqh rulings the way that we describe them and the way we explain them, now it's going to be much easier for you to reflect in your spirituality what are the meanings and the secrets, as some scholars call it, out of this prayer. That's why he said one should have presence of mind, khushu'a, mindfulness, hudur, which is knowing what one says and does. A lot of times we read because we memorize Surah Al-Fatiha, but we don't know what we're reading. Right? Sometimes you realize that you're praying in the tashahud. Right? Maybe barely you decided that I'm praying Dhuhr, Allahu Akbar, and then you're out of it. You perfect all the obligations. That's the problem, because you got used to it. Right? You had it all right. Like if you consider it in the fiqhi way, like as a checklist, you did all right. All these obligations we count, even the sunnah. You say dua al-istiftah, you say ameen, subhan rabbi al-azim, you say all things perfect. But you've never thought of one single thing of all these things. That's the problem. This here, if you lose that, because now he's going to mention the hadith that... Can we stop talking, please? Thank you. If you lose the khushu' in the salah, the only reward you get out of the salah is how much you were present in the salah. That's it. How much you're present, how much your mind and your heart are present in the salah, this is the amount of ajr and reward you get from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, if you consider it as a checklist, you pray dhuhr, you pray asr, you pray maghrib. But what is the thawab that you get out of this? It's actually dependent on your khushu'. That's why I said, al-khushu'u huwa sukunul a'da'i wa hudurul qalbi wa tadabburul qira'ati wa tafahumuha fa'innama yataqabbaru Allahu min as-salati biqadril hudur. Said, humility, khushu', which is limbs being still, presence of mind, and pondering and understanding the recitation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts prayers only to the degree of one's humility. The Prophet ﷺ said, after performing his prayer, a man returns with nothing written for him except a tenth of the reward of it, or a ninth, or an eighth, or a seventh, or a sixth, or a fifth, or a third, or half of it. He mentioned all of these like portions of reward based on the amount of your khushu' and humility in the salah. That's why showing off riya during and outside of prayer is haram. Riya is generally haram, and specifically in the salah, it's haram too. It is acting for the sake of people, which is the opposite of acting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be the ikhlas. So he had to mention these things here to tell you, don't get so much immersed in all these technical details. You have to know them, of course, but you have to keep in mind that there are other spiritual meanings that you have to be aware of, like the khushu' and the humility in your prayer. How much time left? We're done? We cannot take the validators of salah? Okay. I'm not allowed to talk more than this. Okay, so next time, inshallah, we'll start from the invalidators, which is very important, what invalidates the salah, the nullifiers of the salah, and then we'll talk about salatul jum'ah and the rest of the kinds of the salah, inshallah. 5 minutes? Okay, any questions? We have 5 minutes for questions. This is the time that we are allowed for. Yes? But we have to listen to each other. If somebody's in hurry, you can leave quietly and leave the rest to understand. Yes? Sisters, I cannot hear you. Please. It depends on the way you pray dhuhr. So it doesn't matter about the time. What matters is the way you pray dhuhr. So I said, if you pray dhuhr, you couldn't get a chance to stand and try to face the qibla, you do it again regardless if it's the dhuhr time is still on or not. Right? Let's say you prayed it in the right manner, you stood up and you faced the qibla, and then you reached the place while it's the dhuhr time, no, you don't have to repeat it.
Okay. Yeah. But if you're sitting, you have to redo it when you're
Yes, you have to redo it. Doesn't matter, like, even if the time is gone already. Yes.
For the shampoo, if someone got up, but let's say you remember before standing up fully, so you just got up, but then you remember.
Yeah, okay.
Back down,
that's a good question. It depends. If you are closer to the ground, you go back.
Yeah.
If you're closer to the standing position, no. So basically, if you are in a ruku' position, you didn't actually get to the ruku' position, you go back and sit. If you're already like almost full standing straight forward, no, you didn't go back. Yes. So you mean three times over the head? Does it have to be the full head or not? That's the question. Yes. So the three times over the head doesn't have to be the over the whole head. It can be just a part of it. Yes. Is it what? No, the place you are in. While you are already on flight. Okay. You know you can track it. Okay, so you have two options. Whether you can track, it depends on which salah you're talking about. So let's see. What? So it's about your prayer. If you know the dhuhr time is on now, whether in the airport and in the on the plane, for example, whatever country you're flying over, and it's a dhuhr time there, you pray. This also applies for fasting, by the way. So you are entitled with the time that you are now in, regardless of which part of the world. So now I'm on the plane. I just left Canada and there was like 4 hours left before Maghrib. I got on the plane, I moved like 30 minutes later, it's Maghrib time. I see the sunset, I just can break my fast because it's Maghrib for me. Even if it's not Maghrib for Canada, it's not Maghrib for the place I'm going to, it doesn't matter. The time is in the place that I am in right now, for Salah and for fasting. Yes. You did tashahhud in the third rak'ah?
Third rak'ah and fourth rak'ah, or you say three rak'ah together and you...
Sisters, you're giving me a really hard time today. Please.
Third rak'ah or fifth rak'ah, say you did one rak'ah more, so what
to do? No, two different things. In the third rak'ah, you're doing tashahhud?
Third rak'ah. First question is, you did third rak'ah. Instead of second rak'ah, you did third rak'ah.
Okay.
So, says the sahur is okay or...
I really didn't get it. So, did you do the first tashahhud or not? Okay, and then you stood up for the third rak'ah?
No, tashahhud you did in third rak'ah. Instead of second rak'ah, you did in third rak'ah.
Okay. And you are aware of what you're doing? You know, you wanted to make it up for the second rak'ah, or you forgot and you're doing the third rak'ah?
Yeah, forgot. I forgot in second rak'ah, I did in third rak'ah.
Okay. No, you didn't do it. If you're going to second rak'ah, you didn't do it. You didn't do it again. But if you forgot and you're doing the third rak'ah and you're thinking that it's the second rak'ah?
Yeah.
Okay, no, so at the end of the salah, if you realize that this is what you did, yes, you do two other sujood. But this doesn't count, because it doesn't count in the third rak'ah. Yeah. Yes. No. Niyum doesn't start at 12, generally. But no, the time for Isha, it's all the way to the dawn. It's about the Qibla. Oh no, because there was a hadith who explained that. Because the Prophet, when he went and prayed to the Kaaba, he said, that's the Qibla. The other dalil for the other group, they said, there's a hadith that says, between east and west is Qibla. So the some people took the second hadith, they said, okay, that's a dalil, that the general direction is a Qibla. The first group said, you have to face the Kaaba precisely, they said, he said, this is the Qibla, هذه القبلة, that means you have to make sure you face it precisely.
If you miss a commended act during salah, like say subhanAllah al-Azim, subhanAllah al-A'la, do you have to make sujood tashahhud?
No.
So why, like, when you miss tashahhud?
Only certain things that you do tashahhud for, you do sahw for, which is the first tashahhud, or if you do a mistake, like adding something to the salah, for example, or confuse a number of rak'ahs. Yes, we'll take care first, and then you. Yes.
Yeah. Is my prayer valid, let's say, I pray 10 minutes before the time because I have an appointment, let's say, exam, whatever. Then instead of, because I won't reach the asr.
No, no, you cannot pray. You cannot pray before the time. No.
Even I respect.
You have to make. You have to try your best to pray in time. If you really have a serious excuse, I don't know which excuse, but if you really have a serious excuse that really occupies all your time, and then you're gonna make it up, that's a different story. But anyway, you cannot pray before time. No, you cannot pray before time. No, even 5 minutes. It has to be after the time. Yes.
Is it better to pray Jama'ah 5 minutes before the call to the next prayer, or pray alone, like right when the event comes in? So let's say I'm praying at home, and mm-hmm. I can pray Jama'ah at home, but my dad prays 5 minutes before the next salah. Versus if I would have prayed alone, I would have like done it on.
Yeah, but that's a big gap, right? You talk about like 2 hours difference.
Yeah.
No, you pray on time. If that difference, but if you talk about it's a matter of a few minutes, no, you wait for the Jama'ah. Yeah. But it's a matter of that long time, no, you pray alone. Yes, yes. And you can join him in the Jama'ah with another intention and you get thawab. Yeah. Okay, last two questions. Yes.
For sajda,
you said
two sajda? That was, you thought one sajda, they're saying two sajda?
No, sahw is two sajda.
So it was just
after you're done with your tashahud,
yes.
Before you salam, according to this madhab, you do two sajdas and then you sit down and you say salam. Yeah. It's the most complicated thing about salah, by the way. The most difficult thing in the prayer chapter in fiqh is sahw. It's a little bit not really complicated, but it's a little bit difficult compared to the rest of the ahkam. Yes.
So if you say you join the imam, and then the imam does do the salam after the salam, mm-hmm. so do you have to do it after your imam?
To it, you mean you do have to follow him?
You miss the rak'ah, for example, and then you come in, and then when the imam does salam, he does the sajda after.
Okay. So if you're still sitting down, you follow him with the sajda, because you follow his madhab, and then you continue. If you already stood up and you found out that he's doing sajda, don't go back. You continue your prayer.
So then after you're done, do you have to do it?
No. Especially if you didn't know what happened. Here, you don't have to. No, that's not shaking. No, it's not about he's sure about the imam did a mistake or not. Oh, no, that's a different madhab. No. In the Shafi madhab, all sujood al-sahw is before salam. Finish the shahud, and then you make sujood. Other madhab said if you added something or you missed something, that's different. Yeah. But it's before salam. Just not to be confused, sujood al-sahw is all before salam. Okay? Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.